Welcome to the Morning Swim Show for Wednesday, January 25th, 2012. I'm your host, Peter Bush. In the Phoenice Monitor today, we'll talk to a couple of Cincinnati Bearcats swimmers. The men's program, like several others in the country, has been through some hard times recently, losing their scholarship support, while the women have been able to keep theirs, though it hasn't been easy. Joining us right now in the Phoenice Monitor from Cincinnati are Stephanie Conklin and Matt Hargrove. Hey guys, welcome to the Morning Swim Show. How are you?
Good. Thanks for having us.
All right. Well, first of all, start off, tell us a little bit about yourself. What year are you? What do you swim? What do you study?
I am senior academically and I'm an accounting major, but I'm a junior with swimming eligibility.
I am a senior. I am an accounting and finance double major, and I swim breaststroke.
So you guys have had kind of a tumultuous 4 years there with Cincinnati. We mentioned it in the intro. Like a lot of other programs with, you know, not major schools, you've lost a lot of funding. Matt, first of all, how have the guys, you know, been able to keep existing without scholarship funding?
I think initially it came as kind of a shock when we got our scholarships cut and everyone was kind of unsure what to do. But we actually have been able to nail a number of pretty solid walk-ons the last couple of years. And I think it's big a tribute to our coaching staff being really good staff and our great facilities. We have great weight room. We have a great new pool and facility there. It just comes down to when we do have kids come on trips, just showing them what we're all about. Say, we can't necessarily offer you money, but we have good academic programs, and this is our team environment, and this is what we do have to offer.
Now, Stephanie, I understand that the women don't necessarily have scholarships through the athletic department, but you've been able to get it through some private funding. Is that right?
No, we actually have athletic scholarships.
Oh, okay.
The women weren't changed at all. It was just the guys' team. The scholarships were dropped.
Okay. Now, you guys train together, right? It's a, you know, guys and girls all training in the same practice, same pool.
Correct. Same lanes, same cycles. It would be just like a club or age group team. You're all together, one team.
Has it been difficult watching what the guys have gone through?
Yeah, definitely. It's hard. When they came in and told us, everyone was kind of like, well, what's the next step? Are they going to get cut? And a lot went through our minds. But one thing that I looked at when I was going through the college decision process was, does the swim team I'm looking at have a guys team as well? And there were some teams I went to look at that had a guys swimming program and a girls swimming program, and they practiced at different times or they were separated in different lanes. And I really looked at programs where it was only guys and girls together doing the same thing, same sets, same cycles all together, because it just brings so much diversity and it's a completely different environment to have guys and girls mixed together than just a guys team or just a girls team. I went to an all girls high school, so I've had both worlds. I know what it's like to only have girls. And like I said, my club team was guys and girls together, and I like that so much more.
Matt, did Josh Schneider's success help you guys at all in recruiting and convincing people that you could be a successful swimmer there?
Oh, yeah, definitely. There have been actually a couple times in the past where Josh, for whatever reason, was back in Cincinnati visiting family or just visiting old classmates. And Monty would call him up, say, hey, we have some kids here on a recruiting trip or for whatever reason. And Josh would come down to the pool and either swim with us or just talk to the kids, like help give them more of a feel of what the training is like, because we have nailed a couple of pretty solid sprinters out of high school that we're looking to do some things in the next couple of years. And I think a lot of that is attributed to Monty and how he was able to take Josh from a state champion out of high school to an NCAA champion his senior year.
Do you find a lot of the guys on the team are able to get academic scholarships, or, you know, are they from the area and so the tuition maybe isn't as high because it's in state?
Yeah, we have, I'm not sure exactly how many people are getting academic scholarships, but I am receiving some academic scholarship money, and I know a number of my other teammates are as well. I'm sorry, I completely blanked.
That's okay. So, I mean, it sounds like you guys are a little limited in what you can do in, you know, nationwide recruiting, but you can still exist. There's a formula there that you guys are taking advantage of.
Right, exactly.
right. And Stephanie, you are, it looks like, pretty darn close to your Olympic trial cuts.
Yeah, hopefully. Close isn't good enough, though.
So is the hope
it only gets you so far.
So is the hope to get them at conference or NCAAs, or what are you saving up for this year?
Conference is actually short course yards, and you can only get trials cuts in long course meters. So there's a lot of Grand Prix this spring that I'm planning on going to, and trials aren't until, I think, June 25th is when they start. So as soon as Big East is over, there's no break for me. I'm back in the water Monday morning, ready to go, training hard. So hopefully the sooner the better, it'll be stress-free and off my mind. But yeah, hopefully by June 25th, I'll have two.
Now tell us how the women are looking this year. Will you guys have any relays at NCAAs or still trying to qualify them?
Yeah, we actually haven't qualified anyone so far because A cuts are so hard that you really have to wait and just see who gets selected. But we have a couple of really good freshmen. Our relays are looking really, really good. Some people actually can be on multiple relays, so Monty will have to decide at conference whether, like, some people are great for every single relay, but obviously you can't swim every single relay. So he's still toying with it and going through at our dual meets and stuff like that, deciding what the best relay is and whether people should be doing medley relays or freestyle relays and stuff like that. But we're looking pretty good. We have high goals for conference. We're hoping to finish higher than last year. So it's looking promising. Hopefully we'll have at least one, if not two, representative at NCAA this year.
Matt, has the school said anything about the future of the men's program? Have they assured that without scholarships it will continue to exist, or is it, you know, in jeopardy as well, the whole program?
I haven't heard anything about the future. As far as I know, I think they're continuing to hold on to the program for as long as possible. We just got a new athletic director, Whit Babcock, and we're actually really excited to work with him because he's come from a number of schools that did have successful swimming programs. He was at Auburn, West Virginia, and Missouri before he came to Cincinnati, and we're really excited with what he brings to the table and hoping that having the change in the head of the athletic department might actually move us in the direction opposite from getting cut, more towards returning some funding to the school.
That would be great. Well, I don't know if you guys need to do any, you know, fundraising for that sort of stuff, but I understand that you guys have already spearheaded some fundraising efforts for a former teammate who was diagnosed with cancer. Is that right?
That's correct.
Tell us about that, please.
Our teammate, Nate Kramer, he graduated this past June. He was diagnosed with leukemia in May of last year, I think it was.
Yeah, it wasn't. I think he got sick in May. I don't know if they actually got the diagnosis until June. It was right around graduation that he got the actual diagnosis. It might have been May.
And so he's been back and forth, really battling this thing hard. It's really cool to see how upbeat and positive he is. He's one of the nicest, most positive people you could ever hope to meet. And so normally every year we do the Hour of Power, Swim for Cancer Research. We've done that the last 3 years, I think it was. But this year, since one of our own was diagnosed with cancer, we decided to give the Hour of Power a different meaning. And we raised all the money and donated that to Nate's medical fund because the costs through his various treatments, I think right now he's on his either fifth or sixth round of chemotherapy, and the cost that they're just accumulating are just so high. And so we are trying to help and do whatever we can to just give back to him, give back to a guy who's given so much to the university.
It's also really encouraging. He's come to the pool a few times. I know that when he was diagnosed, he was put in the hospital 24/7. He had to move in there. It wasn't like an outpatient thing. And he was in there for months. And I think one day he got a pass, maybe September, October, something like that. And they said, you can go home for like 4 hours if you want to go see your dog or see your grandma or whoever. And he said, I want to go to the pool. And he came to our practice, and it was like he walked in and people almost started crying. It was like people got goosebumps. They were so excited to see him. And you'd have to know Nate. Like, his 4 years here, he was the most upbeat person every day. He was a distance swimmer, so we got pushed over in the distance lane, had to do the hard, grueling sets where some other people were, like, practicing turns or something else, and he was doing, like, 3 1,000s for time. And he was just like, yeah, let's go, let's do it. And that's the same thing with this. They're like, all right, I don't know, the last round of chemo didn't work so well. We're going to have to do another one. He's like, all right, bring it on, let's go. I'm ready to go, I'm ready to fight this. Like, he has never, even his parents said, I don't know where he gets it from. He's never been down. He's ready to go, he's ready to fight, he's not giving up. And if you come into our pool deck, our water bottles all across our lanes are just written Fight for Nate all over it. We have the Live Strong bracelets we've made that are UC swimming, Fight for Nate. We have t-shirts this year that say Fight for Nate. And every day in practice when you go in, you just think Fight for Nate. When you're at the end of a hard set and you aren't doing so well, it's not for you. You're fighting for Nate. You're thinking he's battling for his life. You're battling to get through a 200 fast, you know? So he's been an inspiration to everyone, and like I said, no one knows where he gets it. It's so motivational just to see him, and he's come to our practices a few times, and he actually came to our Hour of Power fundraiser, and it was great to see him. It's great when his parents stop by and say hi. Everyone loves it.
Something to motivate you before this final conference season, right?
Mm-hmm, definitely. We'll be thinking about him at Big East, too.
Sounds like his background as a distance swimmer has prepared him well for a fight with cancer.
Yeah, definitely.
Tough cookie. Well, guys, thank you very much for joining us. Good luck the rest of the year.
Thank you.
Thanks.
All right, that's Stephanie Conklin and Matt Hargrove joining us from the University of Cincinnati. And that is it for today's show. I'm Peter Bush, reminding you to keep your head down at the finish.